Today, we are going to learn about revised Bloom's taxonomy. I'm sure all of you will agree that it is very, very important for us to set learning objectives for the teaching learning process. It's very important not only for the teacher, but for the students also. For a teacher, it is very important because if you learn very good learning objectives, which are encompassing the levels of Bloom's taxonomy, then teaching learning becomes very easy. You can decide right from the beginning where you want to take your learners, at what level you want them to reach. For learners, it is very important because they can set their own learning objectives and they can see where the teacher is going to lead them to. They can also decide on the basis of that whether they would like to go through that teaching learning material, and then it helps them to get motivated in learning also. So that is why setting learning objectives for a teacher is extremely important. Revised Bloom's taxonomy is one of the taxonomies which helps the teacher to set learning objectives. Way back in 1920, Benjamin Bloom and Anderson and Krathwohl, along with other peer members, they devised one taxonomy which helped the teachers to set learning objectives. It is popularly called Bloom's taxonomy. All of you, I'm sure, must have heard of Bloom's taxonomy. Some of you must also be setting learning objectives according to Bloom's taxonomy. The Bloom's taxonomy of learning objectives of the cognitive domain involves knowledge and development of intellectual skills. It helps us to set learning objectives for cognitive domain. In this picture, you can see different levels which are proposed by Bloom's taxonomy. Bottom up, they are knowledge, comprehension, application, analysis, synthesis, and evaluation. These levels identify the level of performance that the learners need to exhibit. That is what the educators think the learner should know or the knowledge they must possess. The levels are ordered from simple to complex and from concrete to abstract. This taxonomy gives a lot of importance to the performance of the learner. Now you are taking a look at a picture which is the comparison between revised Bloom's taxonomy and Bloom's taxonomy. The picture which is on the left hand side shows Bloom's taxonomy, and the picture which is on the right hand side shows revised Bloom's taxonomy. Lauren Anderson and David Krathwohl were team members of Bloom's when he came up with the basic Bloom's taxonomy. Anderson and Krathwohl revised this Bloom's taxonomy in 2001 and brought in 4 major changes to the original taxonomy. They changed the names of the levels from their noun to the verb form. That is, knowledge became remember, comprehension became understand, application became apply, analysis became analyze. Now, look at the topmost 2 levels. In the original Bloom's taxonomy, there were synthesis and evaluation. Lauren Anderson and David Krathwohl were of an opinion that these 2 levels of taxonomy should be switched. That is, evaluate should come lower and create should come higher than that. The reason being, unless and until a learner is able to evaluate, it is very difficult for that learner to reach the level of create. Along with these changes, they also created subcategories of knowledge and cognitive dimension. We will get into these details little later. One of the very important inputs that they have given to the revised Bloom's taxonomy is this, that they gave the noun and the verb, that is the knowledge process and the cognitive process, separate dimensions, creating a knowledge process matrix. Let us take a look at the table which is proposed by revised Bloom's taxonomy. The revised Bloom's taxonomy gives the table. This table has knowledge dimension across the rows and the cognitive process dimension across the columns. Learning objectives are placed inside this grid. The empty cells of the taxonomy table can alert the teacher about areas of content as well as corresponding potential performances that have not been identified. Once the objectives are placed in the grid, relevant and suitable strategies can be adapted by the teacher to achieve those learning objectives. You can also note that the knowledge dimension includes factual knowledge, conceptual knowledge, procedural knowledge, and metacognitive knowledge. Whereas the cognitive process dimension includes remember, understand, apply, analyze, evaluate, and create. You can observe that the cognitive process dimension has different levels of objectives which are to be set by the teacher. So, The teacher can consider a factual knowledge from her content which she intends to teach and design learning objectives for remember level, understand level, or evaluate level, or whichever level she wishes her learners to reach. Now let us take a look at knowledge dimension, under which let's discuss facts, which is also called factual knowledge. Factual knowledge comprises the largest base of information that the learners would learn. It is a basic knowledge that the learners must learn so that they are able to apply it later while achieving higher learning objectives. The factual knowledge has its own meaning, it has its own existence, and it has its own importance. Factual knowledge are bits of information that has a value of itself. As you can see on the screen, there are two subtypes of factual knowledge: knowledge of terminology and knowledge of specific details and elements. Let us learn little more about them. Knowledge of terminology are independent facts which have a meaning of their own. For example, names of freedom fighters, names of different countries of the world, names of different states of India. Alphabets are symbols which can be read later on by the learners. Also names of fruits, names of different vitamins, minerals, and so on. So all those small bits of information which are independent on their own, they have a meaning of their own, but they are not connected with each other. All these facts can be collected together under the title of knowledge of terminology. Now let's take a look at knowledge of specific details and elements. Let's take an example first. Let's consider different crops which are grown in India. Wheat, rice, maize, different kinds of pulses, etc. are grown in India. Now consider the information which is related to them. Which are the different parts of India where these crops are grown? What is the earth which is required for it? There are so many details which are related to memorizing, or these are the details which are necessary that the learner learns. But these are not independent facts. These are connected to each other. When these facts get connected to each other, constituting a holistic big structure of information, it is termed as knowledge of specific details and elements. The other examples are nutrients which are required by our body. You all know that our body needs fats, carbohydrates, proteins, minerals, and vitamins for our growth. When you consider the names of these independently, individually, they would be falling in the category of knowledge of terminology. But when you think of these details together, which are complementing each other, different types of minerals which are complementing each other and which are necessary for the growth of our body, when you consider this holistic picture of the nutrients which are required for our body, they fall in the category of knowledge of terminology and elements. Now let us take a look at the next category of knowledge dimension, which is conceptual knowledge. When the components of the content form intricate interrelationships amongst each other, forming complex schemas, large schemas, models, or theories, this is what is called as conceptual knowledge. Let us take an example here. If you consider the seasons which are caused on Earth, we would need to consider the Earth, the structure of the Earth, the rotation of Earth, the revolution of Earth, and the axis of Earth to understand the concept of seasons. Now, if you consider these as isolated facts, together they will not make any sense. But when these isolated facts start making sense together in such a way that it tries to explain a complex phenomena, it starts formulating a concept. As you can see on the screen, conceptual knowledge includes three subcategories, which are knowledge of classification and categories, knowledge of principles and generalizations, and knowledge of theories, models, and structures. Let us take a look at knowledge of classification and categories. The knowledge of classification and categories include knowledge about specific classes, categories, divisions, etc. It forms connections between terminologies and facts. For example, knowledge of variety of types of literatures, parts of sentences, kinds of psychological problems, classification of numbers as whole numbers, integers, and fractions, etc. Now let us take a look at the next category, which is knowledge of principles and generalizations. Knowledge of principles and generalizations include knowledge about principles and meaningful patterns that are formed by content, which are generalizations. It includes large number of specific facts and events, classifications and categories which were discussed as a previous category and describe their processes and interrelationship. For example, generalizations about particular cultures, fundamental laws of physics, economics, rules of language, mathematical theorems, etc. The next and the last category of conceptual knowledge is knowledge of theories, models, and structures. It includes knowledge of different paradigms, epistemologies, theories, and models that are different disciplines used to understand and explain phenomena. Some examples of these are structures and functions of Lok Sabha, theory of evolution and its related terms which explain different phenomena. Different models and theories which are followed in the field of education are also examples of this category. It is very interesting to know that principles and generalizations which are related to each other formulate theories, models, and structures. Now let us take a look at the next category of knowledge dimension, which is procedural knowledge. Procedural knowledge is the knowledge about how, when, and which procedure to follow. As a part of their learning, students learn different kinds of procedures, be it scientific procedures like solving scientific problems. Typically in physics, they solve a lot of problems. They also learn how to solve mathematical problems. Let us consider the mathematical problems solved by the students. As a part of maths, students solve numerical problems or word problems. While solving numerical problems, generally they know which procedure to follow and how to solve a certain equation or how to solve a certain problem. So this knowledge about how to follow a procedure falls in the category of procedural knowledge. Now, which procedure to follow also falls in the category of procedural knowledge. Now let us consider solving a word problem. Typically, while solving word problems, students need to involve different kinds of procedures. Every procedure has its own steps. So, while combining these procedures, which procedure to select, which one to follow, how to follow that procedure, which fits to solve that problem, the knowledge about all these things falls in the paradigm of procedural knowledge. Now, let us take a look at the categories of procedural knowledge in further details. Now let us take a look at subcategories of procedural knowledge. They are knowledge of subject specific skills and algorithms, knowledge of subject specific techniques and methods, and the third one is knowledge of criteria for determining when to use appropriate procedures. Now let's see the first subcategory of procedural knowledge, which is subject specific skills and algorithms. This includes series of steps to be performed collectively, which are known as procedure. The emphasis of this is on the knowledge of the procedure and not on the ability to use it. The learner is expected only to possess the knowledge of the procedure. For example, algorithms for solving quadratic equations, or for that matter, any kinds of equations. The next category is subject-specific techniques and methods. Some procedures don't produce a fixed end result. One needs to think about how experts would think and use which technique and method to solve the problem. For example, techniques used by scientists for finding solutions to the problems. The next category is the criteria for determining when to use appropriate procedures. The learners, as a part of their learning, know different kinds of procedures. Deciding which procedure to use according to the problem that is faced by the learner falls in this category. Generally, these decisions are taken by the ways in which these procedures are conducted in the past and the kind of results that they have given. It's worth noting here that the first two categories are related to procedures of skills, algorithms, techniques, and methods, whereas the last subtype prepares the learner to decide which skill or method or a technique is the most appropriate one to solve the given problem. For example, consider a scientist who has collected data through her experiment. To analyze this data, the scientist will decide which procedure to follow or which data analysis procedure to follow to come to conclusions. Now, if you know about research methodology, there are several ways in which data can be analyzed. The researcher will need to pick and choose a certain procedure which suits best to the data which he has collected and to draw conclusions from that data. Now we have come to the last category of knowledge dimension, which is metacognitive knowledge. Metacognitive knowledge is about making the learner aware of their own cognition, of their own problem-solving skills, and of their own understanding. It is about preparing them so that they are responsible for their own knowledge. Students learn different strategies for learning, for problem-solving, and managing themselves. Gradually, as they grow, as they start getting matured, they learn how to make combinations of these strategies to solve their own problems. Eventually, they learn about themselves and they learn about which strategies to use, which would work the best for them. And they learn about their own strengths and weaknesses. Let us see the subcategories of metacognitive knowledge. They are strategic knowledge, knowledge about cognitive tasks, including appropriate contextual and conditional knowledge. The third one is self-knowledge. Let us see the details of these subcategories. Let us learn about strategic knowledge. The teacher makes the learners use many different strategies so that the learners learn, such as drawing concept maps for complex contents, paraphrasing or summarizing lengthy content so that the major points are remembered by the learner. They also teach the learners to plan their activities so that they organize themselves to meet their goals. These strategies fall in the category of strategic knowledge. Strategic knowledge is the knowledge of general strategies for learning, thinking, and problem solving that the students might use. Now let's move on to the next category, which is knowledge about cognitive tasks, contextual and conditional knowledge. To understand this category, let's take an example. A carpenter has many types of nails. Each one has a specific use. When he has to mend something, he may use a certain type of nail or may use a combination of the nails. In our context, the thing to mend is a situation or a problem, and the nails are different types of strategies one has learned. This subcategory is to do with the knowledge about which strategy to use for what purpose. It also includes making suitable combinations of these strategies. Some examples are knowledge that true or false types of items stress more on the memory than multiple choice items. Knowing that summarizing and paraphrasing will develop deeper understanding of the content. Knowledge that for solving some advanced geometry related problems, different theorems may be needed to combine. Now let's understand about self-knowledge. Self-knowledge is an important component of metacognition. It is the knowledge of one's strengths and weaknesses related to cognition and learning. When the learners develop self-knowledge, they know when they don't know and how to learn what they don't know. This awareness is about self is extremely important. Its examples are knowledge about self, about the area of expertise and also about the area of inexpertise. Knowledge about how to develop weak areas. Knowledge about personal interests. Knowledge about capability of self without being overconfident to do with a particular task also falls in this category. With this, we have come to the end of learning about knowledge dimension of revised Bloom's taxonomy. Thank you.